So we're going to be talking disc brakes, why you want to go with the Maverick Master Cylinder I have mentioned before, the differences between this one and a boosted master cylinder, and why that is really important to you on the braking on your classic Ford. I feel like I look like I'm throwing that thing at you. Coming up next.
For 45 years, the Miller family and the dedicated staff at Autocrafters have been here helping you to restore your dream Ford. Thank you for your support. Here's to another 45 years of delivering parts for your Falcon, Fairlane, F100, Galaxy, Maverick, and Pinto.
Okay, so what I've got here on Wonky's hood is a set of things. We have a single reservoir master cylinder. This is actually the master cylinder off of Wonky. Then we have next to it a disc brake master cylinder for power brakes. And then next to that, we have a manual disc brake master cylinder for 1974. And from what I understand from something someone left me in the comments, on up Maverick and possibly Granada. Next to that, we have a proportioning valve. And I'm going to talk about proportioning valves first. At this stage in the game, I would say that if you don't do this, you're probably missing out on a better braking car. A proportioning valve is going to work to keep your proportions correct between front and rear brakes. Your goal, and I've said this before, in braking the car, not braking it, but braking it, is to keep all four tires from locking up. As soon as you lose traction on those tires, you lose braking performance. You have lost control of the vehicle. So your goal in all of this is to have better braking performance, and a proportioning valve is going to provide you with that in a way that the one I'm showing you right now, these type of valves with a little screw on the top of them, will not. The problem you may run into is you may not be able to find a proportioning valve that actually suits your needs for the particular car that you're working on. But we have one available for these. The cool thing is I'm working on a 64 Falcon and doing this, as I've shown you already. So a 65 Mustang proportioning valve will work. One that's set up for anything up through probably 69 Mustang or Falcon. So that right there is a nice thing. You will be able to use this proportioning valve in order to get what you need out of your car. Now, the next thing I'm going to talk about on this is the difference between these two master cylinders. A lot of you guys will say, well, geez, they look exactly identical. They're the same master cylinder, but they are not. All right, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to sit these up on end because I'm going to talk about why there is a difference here and what is going on. As I've said, this is a disc brake power boosted master cylinder, and this one is a disc brake non-power boosted master cylinder. And honestly, if I'm doing a disc brake kit on a car that's got a whole lot of power to it and you've got a real low vacuum signal, this is probably going to be your best bet, because otherwise you're going to have to put a vacuum pump on your booster in order to make your brakes work with a power assisted system. Most of your boosters that are out there right now require between 15 and 22 inches of vacuum in order to operate correctly. So keep that in your mind. If you're below 15 inches of vacuum at idle, your brakes are probably not going to operate correctly unless you can put a vacuum can on them, which is going to be limited in the amount of boost it can give you, or you're going to have to put a vacuum pump like the one I'm showing you right here. Those two things need to be done in order to run a boosted system. So that's out of the way. This is what you're going to want to do with a manual disc brake system. Now, I'm going to do some things here to show you why that's important. Now I'm going to put my digital caliper down in here and measure my bore diameter. My bore diameter is 0.982, and that's an inch because I didn't do a specific hard measurement on it. And the one for disc brake boosted is a 1.093. Now, my main logic in my brain would tell me that the bigger the bore, the better you're going to have for braking performance in a situation. You could just go ahead and put that on your car and not put the booster behind it and everything is going to be copacetic. That's not true. Believe it or not, this one is a better solution for disc brakes without power, because the larger the bore, like the bore on this one, the more pedal effort it's going to require to actually apply the brakes. The smaller the bore, the less pedal effort you're going to be seeing to apply the brakes. There are also a couple of other differences on this as well. I'm going to take my caliper again, set it down through the center on the hole here, and go to the dead middle. And that is at 1.234. The one inside the disc brake power master cylinder is a 1.357. So the plunger that goes in here is actually the plunger that's on the booster itself. That's what's why that's deeper. If you were to try to use this, you would actually have to get a different plunger for it to use it without the booster. But even if you're trying to do that, because of the bigger bore, your brakes are not going to work as effectively. Now, I'm going to set these things back down normally. I don't know how I feel about this, by the way. This is actually an aluminum master cylinder. Very normal in the course of things with modern cars. Classic cars, almost always they were cast iron, which is what this one is. So I don't know how I feel about that yet. Maybe in the long term I'll say it's great and I'm okay with it. I don't know. Next thing I'm talking about is, you may wonder why I have a single bowl master cylinder in here when I'm talking about what to do with these for disc brakes. The simple fact is with a single bowl master cylinder, anything prior to 1967, when the federal government mandated a dual reservoir braking system on cars, you had a setup that was different for brake lights. Now, the 66, the Falcon that this one came out of, this port here was actually used as part of the braking system, but on the earlier cars, 1965 on back, this was actually your port for the brake light switch. Now, they may have changed that in 65 on the Falcons and some of the other cars, but I do know 64 on back for sure, this is where your brake light switch came out to. So it used the pressure from the system to operate your brake lights on the car. And you'll have to modify in order to use these, unless you just want to try to put a line that goes out to the switch. In other words, the switch is mounted on your brake line somewhere for your disc brakes, and put the switch out there in the engine bay still. I don't prefer that type of switch. I find them to not operate quite as well as a standard underdash brake switch, but there you go. At least we know in 1966 on this particular style Falcon that they did have an underdash brake light switch. I feel like I've given you a fire hose of information. Some of the information will be broken out a little bit in the description below, so you can check that out. If you have any kind of questions, please feel free to drop them into the comments, and we'll do another video on a sidebar if we absolutely have to in order to further explain this. So now I'm going to go out and I'm going to show you why you can have a problem with using a boosted system in an early Falcon and even an early 65.6 Mustang because of what can go on with just spatial issues. It's very spatial. Sorry. All right, so now I'm going to talk about why you have some chassis issues on some of these early cars. Now, this is our 64 Falcon hardtop that we've been working on for a little while here on Manic Mechanic. We've already got our strut and brake kit in here from RRS. So that is the need for us to go in and put in the Maverick manual disc brake master cylinder. I've got the master cylinder sitting in here, kind of at a cockeyed angle, just to show you how little room there really is in a 1960 all the way up to 1965 Falcon. These cars were designed for a single reservoir master cylinder like the one that's already in here, not a dual reservoir master cylinder. And then if you try to put a booster in on top of that, the room issues that you're going to have are going to eat you alive. So what you really want to do is just go with this one, unless you are wanting to just do more and you want to have power brakes on the car. I would try this first. This is a cheap alternative to what it's going to cost for an underdash brake booster from the guys at RRS. It's a great system. If you're doing a Coyote swap or you're putting a different engine in here, I would recommend looking at that. But anytime you go underdash brake booster, it's just not going to be an inexpensive option. This is an inexpensive option to a single reservoir master cylinder, which I've already told you in the past you need to get rid of, because they are an issue for if your brakes go out. So this is kind of what it looks like. It will fit in here, and you should still be able to access the bales and all. You may have to put a little tube in there to add fluid to the rear section of your brakes. Remember, on these dual reservoir master cylinders, the one I'm showing you right now, the front is for your rear brakes and the back is for your front brakes. It doesn't make sense, just like the smaller bore having better braking prowess than the larger bore, but that's just how this works with the geometry and all that doo-doo that goes into that. So there you go. That's what this basically is. On an early Mustang or Falcon, that master cylinder will work great on a disc brake conversion. Same thing with the Maverick. That's one of the reasons why they did it initially in 1974, was they were having a problem trying to figure out how to fit a booster in there and have a strut tower brace at the same time. The picture I'm showing you right now is what they finally came up with in, I believe, 75 for for putting a boosted master cylinder assembly in the Maverick. And you can see that is just the weirdest looking strut tower brace I've ever seen in my life. So there you go. All right, folks, you know the drill. Be kind to each other, love on each other. Please treat each other nice. You guys have a great week and we'll see you on down the road. Now, coming up on this particular car, we are going to try to get this thing back on the street again. My wife has been hounding me to get the 64 hardtop rolling again. So that's one of our future things we're going to be doing. Hopefully we're working out with the guys at Modern Driveline to put a 5-speed in this thing initially. That 5-speed will then move over to Logan's Ranchero when we put the 289 and the manual shift mechanisms off of this car in it. So many convolutions. It was really fun trying to explain that to Bruce Kuchar over at Modern Driveline. My goal for this one eventually is our 347 with a TKX, so we can show you how to set the tunnel up and pie cut your tunnel in order to put all that together in a car like this with that bigger transmission, because the tunnels on these things are terrible. I've talked too long. You're probably not even paying attention anymore. And if you are, good on you. Bye.